Apple spent its first full year without Steve Jobs, released new tablets and a phone, but also made a series of high-profile mistakes in doing so. For the first time, the company's perfectionist reputation took a fall. This is a look back at Apple for 2012. It was Apple's first full year with CEO Tim Cook at the helm, and analysts were eager to see how he'd do in the role. It was also a big year for the company as it rolled out a new smartphone, tablets, and updated its operating system, as well as other tweaks to existing programs. 2012 saw Apple reach MVP status for most valuable public company in history. But with high-flying success and a booming app store, the company also made some embarrassing mistakes. In mobile phones, Apple released its iPhone 5 in the fall, which has a slightly larger display in length only compared to the previous phone, the 4S. The phone has a Retina display but does not contain a near-field communications chip, as some had hoped it would, which would have enabled payment with tap and go like some Android devices. There were reports about poor working conditions in the Foxconn factories in China, where Apple products are made. In the fall, an employee riot broke out at a Foxconn plant in China. And China Labor Watch, an advocacy group, reported workers striking over production schedules before the iPhone 5 launch. While Foxconn builds electronics for many major brands, most remain mum on using Foxconn. While brands like Cisco, Huawei, Nintendo, Sony, and Nokia have confirmed using the company. Still, analysts say Apple is responsible for about 40% of Foxconn's revenue. The labor concerns sparked international complaints and demonstrations by consumers. Late in the year, Apple announced it would bring production of at least one Apple product, something in the Mac line, back to the U.S. in 2013. Foxconn then confirmed it may expand its manufacturing operations in the U.S.
But it's interesting to see that in the background, like so many things where Apple declares it's impossible and then they actually do it, that they are actually trying to bring back computer manufacturing to the U.S. So we'll see how it does, but I don't think that would have happened without the criticism.
2012 was also a big year for Apple's iPad, when Apple released the third version of its iconic tablet, called simply the new iPad, in March. Then, baffling some, Apple updated a fourth regular-sized iPad 7 months later. At the same time, it unveiled its new mini tablet, roughly 2 inches smaller than the regularly-sized iPad. Pricing for the mini iPad was set about $130 higher than other similarly-sized tablets from other makers, confounding analysts who had expected Apple to price the smaller tablet competitively.
To get an iPad, you need to pay $350, and to get an Android tablet or a Kindle Fire, you can pay $199. So it's a big difference. I'll say the iPad mini is bigger. The screen is bigger, so there's some value there. The experience is also better. The apps are better.
About the same time, Apple angered consumers when its new mobile operating system, iOS 6, killed Apple's long-standing arrangement with Google to provide mapping. Instead, it was replaced with a new Apple mapping feature that got mixed reviews, working well in highly populated areas, but also giving embarrassingly incorrect directions elsewhere. Some Apple consumers held off on updating to iOS 6 because of it. The move sent Google scrambling to create an app for Apple devices. That app was released in December, and perhaps not coincidentally, iOS 6 adoption jumped after that.
So in the end, I think consumers win because they can choose Apple's, they can choose Google's, and the Google stuff is more full-featured than it used to be. So it just took a long time to get there, and Apple definitely got egg on its face.
Scott Forstall, the Apple employee in charge of Apple Maps and all of the iOS, was let go from the company late in the year.
People say that this is a sign that Apple is in decline, the fact that this guy who was the architect of iOS has been shown the door. I don't know. I feel like iOS hasn't changed very much in the last few years. It's been pretty static. And this is the guy who's been in charge of iOS all that time, Scott Forstall. So by kicking him out and putting some new people in there We may actually see Apple have the bravery to make some changes to iOS for the first time in 5 years.
Apple continued to be front and center in numerous patent battles. Among the most high profile, a judge ruled in favor of Apple in a dispute with Samsung over copyright claims for smartphones. The damage award totaled $1.05 billion. That same California judge then asked for Samsung and Apple to work out their differences, calling for global peace between the two companies. The patent wars continue, with other juries finding Apple guilty of infringing on patents owned by Sony, Nokia, and others. Apple also settled a patent suit with HTC. But the year may just end on a sour note for the company, as Apple's stock valuation took a steady decline in the last few months. So what's ahead for Apple in 2013? Snell says assuredly more patent fights, more Foxconn drama, and most likely of all, more products that consumers will most definitely buy. But will they buy them in lower numbers due to better products from Apple competitors?
You know, I think Apple could just stop selling things tomorrow and stay in business for another decade at least. But, you know, it will keep going. The question is, can it keep innovating? Can it stay on the cutting edge, or will its competitors start catching up to it? And, you know, who knows?
This was a look back at Apple for 2012 from IDG. From San Francisco, Carrie Davis, IDG News Service.